Now let's have a look at servlets. So servlets is the technology to handle HTTP communication in Java EE. Actually, we're not going to write any servlet in this course. The fact is that you seldom have to write any servlet at all, because it turns out that the task to receive an HTTP request and dispatch it to a component that can handle that particular request is in itself infrastructure code that is similar between different applications. So therefore, the servlet is part of the Spring Web MVC framework that we will look at in the next video. Okay, but this video is to give you an understanding of servlets anyway, because they are used in our application even though we don't write them ourselves. So we already know that a servlet lives in a servlet container and is used, at least in our application, to interact with a web client using HTTP. So it executes inside the service JVM. The call to the servlet is just a plain method call. And it allows creating dynamic web pages. We can create even HTML inside the servlet, but it's a bit cumbersome and clumsy to write HTML code in the Java program. So instead, the servlet is mainly used as controller, meaning it receives the HTTP request and then forwards it to the appropriate model components that can handle that request. And in that way, the servlet becomes a gateway between the web clients, for example, browsers and other things in the backend, such as often plain Java objects. But in the end, further down the call chain, we reach a database. The servlet generates the HTTP response, but not the HTML response normally. We do not write HTML code in a servlet. So a servlet is a Java class that implements the Java Servlet interface, and such a class implementing this interface can be used for any request response based interaction, not just HTTP. But if we are using HTTP, it is more appropriate to, instead of implementing the interface, extending the class Java Servlet HTTP HTTP Servlet, which provides some basic functionality for HTTP protocol. So this is how a servlet receives an HTTP request and generates a response. At the client, there is an HTML page in the browser. The user clicks a button or a link or something, and that way generates an HTTP request. The HTTP request arrives at the server. Here's the server. The server has the TCP port where the connection is established between the browser and the server, and the server receives the HTTP request, which is sent over TCP. The server then will see that the URL that this HTTP request is sent to is mapped to a servlet, if that is the case, and we'll soon see how such a mapping is done. So the server realizes that this is a request that should arrive at the servlet container. Here's the servlet container. The server then will call the servlet. In particular, it will invoke the service method of the servlet. So remember that the servlet had to implement the servlet interface. And even if the servlet instead extends the HTTP servlet class, it still implements that interface, because HTTP servlet extends the servlet interface. And this interface defines the service method. So in step two here, when we are in the servlet container and the servlet container calls the servlet, the call to the servlet is just a call to the service method of that servlet object. So there we see an example of how a container can invoke a component. The component implements an interface that is defined by the container. Okay, we are in the service method of the servlet, and that method will call other objects to perform what work has to be done. The objects performing the work, controller and model and database, eventually return some result, and the servlet transforms the result into an HTTP response, which is then sent back to the browser. So this is the general picture, but if instead of implementing the service interface, we extend the HTTP servlet class, then the service method is already defined in that class, and instead we have to override methods called do post, do get, and so on. There is one of those for each HTTP method. And it's the HTTP servlet class that will interpret the request and check which HTTP method was used, and then invoke the appropriate method. We have to override them to provide an implementation handling that particular request. If we do not override the method, the request will not be allowed. Now let's have a look at the lifecycle of a servlet. So the servlet container invokes the servlet, but when is the servlet object created? So this is what happens when a request is mapped to a servlet. That is, when the container realizes that the particular URL of an HTTP request should result in a call to a servlet object. First, the container will load the servlet class, unless that was done already as a result of a previous HTTP request. But supposing this is the first time there is a call to this particular servlet, then the container loads the class from the file system. And for that to be possible, the servlet class must of course be available on the class path at a location defined by the container where the container can find the class. And that is what's called deployment, to place the servlet class at the place where the container can find it. Okay, so the container eventually loads the class, then the container will create an instance of that class, a new object of the class. And also it will invoke the init method to initialize it. So in the init method we can place initialization code. So important to understand also that when the container creates the servlet object, it can only call the no argument constructor. Also, there are things happening after the constructor has been called. So initialization code of the servlet should be placed in the init method, not in the constructor. Then, after the first two steps, the servlet object exists and it's ready to serve HTTP requests. And the container then invokes the service method for each HTTP request directed at this servlet. And if the servlet is a subclass of the HTTP servlet class, then the HTTP servlet class has the service method, which will check the HTTP method of the request and call its method with the same name as the HTTP request. So if it's a GET HTTP request, the DoGET method will be called, and so on. And if eventually the container decides to remove the servlet, for example if it runs out of memory or some resource, then before unloading the servlet from the container, it will call the servlet's destroy method. So in the destroy method we can place cleanup code. And when the doGet or doPost or do whatever method is called in our servlet class, that method will receive two objects: the HTTP servlet request object and the HTTP servlet response object. So the request object contains getters to get information about the request, like read HTTP headers or get HTTP parameters. And the response object provides methods for creating the response, methods for example to set HTTP headers. And it has an outstream, and whatever is written to that outstream will be sent to the browser. So now let's have a look at a sample servlet. So here is a Java class, it's called Hello Servlet, and it extends the HTTP servlet. Also it provides the doGet method, which means that it can answer HTTP GET requests. This line here shows how to define the URL to which the servlet shall answer. So this thing here is the URL. So an HTTP request ending with this path will be directed to this servlet. And this thing here is just the logical name of the servlet. These things are defined with the web servlet annotation. Okay, so let's have a look at the doGet method then. We can see that the objects, the servlet request object and the servlet response objects, are passed to this method. First, we use the response object. Response, this is the response object, to set an HTTP header, namely the content type here. Then we retrieve the outstream from the response object, and whatever is written to this outstream out here will be sent over HTTP to the browser. So then we just print things here and then finally close the outstream. So this is not appropriate. This is just the first example. You can see you get a lot of string handling here. Just getting the pluses and the quotes correct will be a burden if you were to always generate HTML pages like this. And also no HTML designer would be very happy about reading HTML code written like this, and no HTML tool would be able to understand this. Actually, it's never a good idea to mix different programming languages. And now don't start a discussion on whether HTML is a programming language. We should not mix Java and HTML like this. But instead, the doGet method will contain calls to other frameworks like JSF and EJB and so on, and will receive answers from those, including HTML. So the task of the servlet is just to handle the HTTP protocol. Okay, but this is the first example, and this of course is valid code that will generate such a web page. You can see it here. So this is the web page generated by the servlet on the previous page, and this is the HTML code of that web page. And if we wish, we can override the method getServletInfo to provide some information to an IDE or whatever about the servlet. But that is not required, and there is nothing in the servlet specification defining how the thing returned by the getServletInfo method should be used. So now let's have a look at a few particularities in the servlet specification. First is that we can monitor and react to the servlet's lifecycle events. For example, when the servlet is started, or when the web application is started, or when an HTTP session is started, or many other things. Here's an example listening for application startup and shutdown. So the web listener annotation here tells that this is a listener for web application events. So the class, we have called this class context listener, must implement the interface servlet context listener, which defines the methods context initialized, that is called when the web application is started, and context destroyed, which is called when the web application is shut down. In the context initialized method, we place the code that shall be executed on web application startup. And in this example here, we retrieve a connection to a database. So let's assume that book.dao is the database access object of some book database. And by creating this object, we perhaps connect to the database. So we create this object here and then store it in the context. The context that is retrieved here, context is the context defined here that is of type servlet context, is an object defining the servlet's view of the servlet container. So many of the Java EE containers have such context objects defining the container. So this context object contains methods that the component, in this case the servlet, might invoke to get information or configure the container in which it lives. And here we use the fact that it is possible to store objects in this context object. So the book.dao stored in the book.db variable is set as an attribute. The object is stored in the context. So this is the book.db, that book.db. And it is stored under the logical name bookdb in the servlet context. This context here is the context that was retrieved there and defined here. And this object that was stored in the context can be retrieved by any servlet. And this code, the context destroyed, that is executed when the application is shut down, performs cleanup. It retrieves the attribute defined by the logical name bookdb, which is this bookdb containing the book.dao. Okay, and then call remove on this. So the idea is that this remove method should shut down database connections, for example. And then finally remove the attribute from the context. So now on this line we also remove the object stored in the servlet context. And there are many different servlet and application lifecycle events for which we can register listeners. So here's a list of some. I will not go through them. It is also possible to define filters. So we can think like this, that we have an incoming HTTP request that is directed towards a servlet in the servlet container. So everything here takes place in the servlet container. Okay, the incoming HTTP request is directed towards the servlet, and eventually there will be an outgoing HTTP response. And it is possible to define filters, any number of filters, that the request will pass on the way in and the response will pass on the way out. And these filters can do any handling of the request, write to logs, compress, perform some security check, for example. Now let's see how the servlet can access the web context. So we saw previously that the context listener used the web context to store the DAO object, the book.dao object. Now let's see how a servlet can access the context, for example to retrieve that object. So here we have a servlet in the class catalog servlet. It is an HTTP servlet, and we see that here that in the init method, remember that the init method was for configuration for startup code. You should not use the constructor because the object is not completely ready when the constructor is executed. Okay, so here in the init method, we call the getServletContext method, which is defined in the HTTP servlet class. So the getServletContext method will return the ServletContext object, and in that object we call getAttribute, and bookDB was the logical name of the bookDAO object that was stored. So we cast it to bookDAO and then can store it in the bookDB variable, which is of type bookDAO. Okay, so that was a very short example showing how an object could be stored in the servlet context object by the listener and later retrieved by a particular servlet. So that was a very brief overview of the servlet container. We now have an idea about how servlets can be created, and we have some understanding about things that can be done with the servlet.